Now, how do we define whether a data flow value is a sound representation of a concrete value? So once again, we want to connect the abstract worlds and the concrete worlds. So we have this abstraction function. You take a set of states S and apply abstraction function and get alpha S. And it's possible that you might apply, you may want to apply, you may want to concretize it. So when you concretize, when you apply gamma to alpha of S, when you apply the concretization function to this, there should be a guarantee that what we get is a superset. Meaning, once we abstract and concretize, there is no loss of information. Let's look at an example. Let's say our set of states is A maps to 2 and B maps to 10, and A maps to 4 and B maps to 10, and our abstract value is a value range, an interval. So our abstract value could be A maps to the range 2 to 4, both being inclusive, and B maps to range 10, 10. So this represents only value 10, whereas this represents value 2, 3, and 4. So that's our alpha. And when we apply the function gamma to it, we get this state. Not only do we get the previous states, A maps to 2 and B maps to 10, A maps to 2 and B maps to 10, and the other state, A maps to 4 and B maps to 10, we also have A maps to 4 and B maps to 10. However, we get an additional state in which A maps to 3 and B maps to 10. Meaning, when we abstract out a value and once again concretize it, we only get a larger set. So we say that concretization after abstraction gives a sound over approximation of the abstracted behaviors. Can we do the other way around? What happens if we concretize an abstract value and then abstract it? So if we concretize an abstract value D, we get gamma of D, and then when we abstract it further, we get alpha of gamma of D. And what we want is our abstraction and concretization functions should be such that after concretization, when we abstract it, there should be no loss of precision. We should get a value which is no lower than D. In fact, we should get a value that is a higher than D, that is stronger than D. So here we have this example. We have value range 2, 4 and 10, 10. We concretize it, we get this set of states. A is 2, B is 10, A is 3, B is 10, A is 4, B is 10. Now, when we abstract it once again, we get back the same state. We cannot get a state that is weaker than, we cannot get a data flow value. We cannot get an abstract value that is weaker than the value that we started with. So, meaning abstraction after concretization does not cause any imprecision. And in most cases, alpha of gamma of D is equal to D and is not stronger than D in most cases, not unequal to D. So, for ensuring soundness, we need to design monotone functions alpha and gamma satisfying what is called a Galois connection. This is something that we saw just now. Gamma of alpha of S is a superset of S. When you start with a concrete world, abstract it, and once again concretize it, you're going to get the superset of the original set of states that you started with. And conversely, if you take a data flow value, you concretize it, and once again abstract it, you get a value that is likely to be stronger than D. This relationship is called a Galois connection. Note that in most cases, and most certainly in the data flow analysis that we will see, we get something, we get a restricted version of Galois connection called Galois insertion, where the first condition remains same, but the second condition, as we noted in the previous slide, that abstraction after concretization gives us the same value and not a more precise value. Besides this, it's interesting to note that there is no need to define alpha and gamma both. In general, it is sufficient to define one of alpha or gamma, and the other function can be derived from the defined function. There are many more details of this, and there is a large body of static analysis called abstract interpretation, which we are not going to study as a part of this course, you can read up the relevant literature on this. We will use this abstraction function, we will define a formal soundness criteria when we talk about solutions of data flow analysis. So having seen the formalization of soundness, formalization of abstraction, we come back to the world of data flow analysis. Why we use lattice for representing data flow values? It is suitable because the weaker than relationship captures approximations for soundness. Meaning, when X is weaker than Y, we say, we pronounce it as X is weaker than Y. When this happens, the data flow information represented by X captures all runtime behaviors represented by the data flow information Y. Because X weaker than Y implies gamma X is a superset of gamma of Y. It is in this sense that at the start of the lecture, we said that gamma captures validity for approximation, and when we say X approximates Y, X can be used safely in place of Y. And we had seen examples of approximations of money for income and expenditure, and time for travel, and time for study. So, when X is weaker than Y, X is more conservative than Y for soundness, implying that X can be safely used in place of Y. However, since it may capture more behaviors, it may be imprecise. So, although we may want to use X weaker than Y, we want to use largest such X. And therefore, when we have y1 and y2, we want to use the largest value which is weaker than y1 and y2. And therefore, we compute the greatest lower bound. Note that this relationship gives us lower bounds. So, x meet y computes the greatest lower bound of x and y, that is largest z, such that z is weaker than X and Z is also weaker than Y. This is the largest safe approximation of combining data flow information represented by X and Y. And that's the role of meet operation. We have two different pieces of data flow information. We want to compute one data flow information, which is a safe approximation. For soundness, we want it to be a safe approximation, but for precision, we want it to be the largest safe approximation. And therefore, this GLB, computing greatest lower bound, is something that represents exactly what we do. And therefore, lattice theoretic representation of data flow values is very useful for our purpose. The G in GLB facilitates precision, and the LB in GLB ensures soundness. Coming back to why the properties of the partial order relation, the relation that represents lower bounds and the operation that computes greatest lower bounds, why these properties are relevant, let's see. This relation weaker than is reflexive if X is weaker than itself. It is transitive if when X is weaker than Y and Y is weaker than Z, we can conclude that X is weaker than Z. And it is antisymmetric when X is weaker than Y and Y is weaker than X, we can conclude that X is equal to Y. This is useful in data flow analysis because it says X can be safely used in place of Y. Then transitivity says that if x can be safely used in place of y and y can be safely used in place of z, then x can be safely used in place of z. Antisymmetry says that if x can be used in place of y and y can be safely used in place of x, this must be possible only when x is same as y. The GLB operator, the meet operation that computes the greatest lower bound, we saw that it must be commutative, it must be associative, and it must be idempotent. Commutativity says x meet y is same as y meet x. Associativity says that when we have to merge three values, it doesn't matter whether you do y meet z first and then merge it with x, or whether you merge x with y first and then merge with z. And idempotent says x meet x is equal to x. Why is this useful? This is useful because commutativity says the order in which data flow information is merged does not matter. So you may have two predecessors. It doesn't matter which value do you pick up. Do you pick up the value of the first predecessor or the second predecessor first? It doesn't matter. You're going to get the same result. Similarly, associativity allows n-ary merging without any restriction on the order. So you might have multiple predecessors, doesn't matter in which order you're going to merge the values, eventually you're going to get the same result. And idempotence is something very important. Idempotence says there is no loss of information if x is merged with itself. Top is the identity of meet. In presence of loops, we might have self-dependence of data flow information. Using top as the initial value for cyclic dependence facilitates computation of the largest safe approximation. Recall that the top represents abstraction of no state reaching. Thus, it represents something. It represents a situation when we have not computed any information. And that's very, very useful in performing data flow analysis. So what is the final recipe for the set of data flow values? In order to set up a set of data flow values, we require a meet semi-lattice satisfying the descending chain condition. Why? Because our main requirement is GLB must exist for all non-empty finite subsets. And a corollary is a bottom must exist. If GLB exists for all non-empty finite subsets and descending chain condition is satisfied, then we know that a bottom element exists. And how? And we will just see it shortly. The top may or may not exist. It can be added artificially. So what guarantees the presence of bottom? Assume that we have two maximal descending chains. They are maximal because each descending chain is finite. So we can talk about chains that are longest. So assume two maximal descending chains terminate into two incomparable elements x1 and x2. So there is one descending chain which terminates on x1. There's another descending chain which terminates on x2. So we have now two descending chains and we are saying that x1 and x2 are incomparable. Now, what would happen in this case? Our requirement is that GLB must exist for all non-empty finite subsets, which means that their GLB must exist for x1 and x2 as well, which means that there must exist a z which is GLB of x1, x2. And if there exists a z which is weaker than x1, x2, then these two chains are not maximal. There is a longer chain that terminates on z because both these chains can be extended to include z. Thus, extending this argument to all strictly descending chains, it's easy to see that there must exist a unique bottom element. If top does not exist, we can add it artificially, and this makes the lattice complete. We will not go into the details, the proof of why this is so, but it is sufficient to know that this is so. So now let's look at lattices in data flow analysis. We have seen the lattice for all expressions. Let's say assuming three expressions, we have this kind of a lattice for available expressions analysis. We define something called a component lattice, a lattice for a single expression, which is this expression, which is it's either 1 or 0, meaning this expression is available or this expression is not available. And now it's easy to see that this lattice is nothing but a Cartesian product of this lattice. Okay, Cartesian products if sets are used, vectors or tuples if bits are used, and then we can define. So this is the actual lattice that we need to understand. Once we understand the top and bottom and partial order relation in this, we can easily compute top and bottom and partial order in the product lattice from these component lattices. So component lattice for data flow information, component lattice for data flow information represented by bit vectors is 1 0, that's one possibility, or 0 1, which is the other possibility. We use this for available expressions analysis, and we use this for live variables analysis. Here is the component lattice for integer constant propagation. Note that here the top element represents empty set and the bottom element represents universal set. Note the over approximation. Merge of the meet of the union of any two singleton sets which are distinct from each other gives us the universal set. So overall lattice L is a set of mappings from variables to this lattice L cap. This lattice is L cap. Okay. The interesting thing to note here is that all descending chains are finite. Any strictly descending chain has length exactly 2, but the lattice itself is not finite because its width is infinite. It doesn't matter to us if the width is infinite, so long as the descending chain condition is satisfied. We know that we start with top and the values keep descending the chain, and at some point of time our algorithm will terminate, and we will talk about this in greater details in the next part of the lecture. And this is the meet operation that we had seen before. We can also define component lattice for may points to analysis, which is the relation between pointer variables and the locations in the memory whose addresses the pointer variables store. So assuming three locations L1, L2 and L3, the component lattice for a pointer P is that P does not hold the address of any location. P holds the address of L1 or L2 or L3, or P holds the address of some two locations, or P holds the address of all three locations, you know, along some path or the other path. This can also be represented as, if we just talk about the pointy set of P, this is the lattice for the possible pointy set of P. We can also define a lattice for must points to analysis, which is that a pointer must point to, when we say a pointer holds the address of location L, it must hold the address of location L along every path. What that means is a pointer can point to at most one location. So therefore we say initially unknown. This is an artificial top element that we add. And the pointer holds the address of L1 or L2 or L3 or none of them under must relation, because along every path it must be the same location. So if there are along one path it is L1 and along the other path it is L2, their meet gives us none. Pointer does not hold the address of any location along every path. This can again be represented like this. Finally, we can also have a general lattice for may must analysis, where we record this information. Must says information must hold along every path. No says information does not hold along any path. And may says information may hold along some path and may not hold along some other path. Note that in case of available expressions analysis and live variables analysis, we had merged this may with must for live variables analysis, and may with no for available expression analysis, but we can have a better lattice like this. So we, and then unknown is again a top which doesn't have, which may be an artificial element, nothing is known yet, or it represents the fact that we do not have a single state reaching that program point. And if along one path we know that the information does not hold, and along the other path information must hold, then their meet gives us may lattice. So this can be used to represent may and must points to information. So we can say P points to L under may relation, P points to L under must relation, P points to L under no relation, meaning P does not point to L, or P points to L under unknown relation, meaning we do not know anything about the pointer yet. So that covers the world of data flow values, and in the next lecture we will start talking about the operations that given a value compute some other value. We will start talking about the flow functions. So far we have seen what is the world of values, what are the properties of values, what is the relationship between data flow values, and we have seen the properties of merge operation on the data flow values.